Yep, it is time for a new Lightroom video. In this video though, I'm not going to edit my own photos, I'm going to edit your photos. Welcome to my channel. Here I talk about photography and I make videos just like this one, where I share how I edit in Lightroom. So, if you're here for the first time, it might be a good idea to subscribe. If you saw this Lightroom tutorial video, you will know that last month I launched a new Lightroom challenge, where I was asking you guys to post your RAW files on Instagram so that I could pick a few photographs and make a video while editing them. Well, this is that video. And before going into Lightroom, I'd like to say thank you for posting your images. And a special thanks goes to those of you that I contacted and sent me the RAW files so I can actually make this video. Okay, enough thanking, let's get started. And here we are in Lightroom. This is the image that I picked to edit. This image is by Chris Collier. I hope I'm pronouncing his name correctly. And I decided to use this image because I wanted to use the opportunity of this video to show you how I edit long exposure photography images. And this is perfect. As a matter of fact, Chris used the 544 seconds shutter speed, an aperture f11, and an ISO of 200. So 544 seconds shutter speed give us the potential of encounter all the problems of a very long exposure. Let's stop talking and let's start editing. I'm of course in the develop module and I will start by opening the crop and straighten panel. And the very first thing of course I want to do is to make sure that my horizon is perfectly straightened. And the next thing I want to do in this panel is deciding what is the best aspect ratio for this image. And in my opinion, the aspect ratio of 16 by 9 is perfect for this image. And I think it looks pretty good. Let's open up the basic panel. And looking at the histogram, I can see that I possibly can open up this image a little bit. And if I hold the shift key and double click on whites, I can extend the histogram all the way to the right in order to have the entire dynamic range available in this image. I will do the same thing, hold shift key, double click on blacks in order to move the image as much as possible to the left as well. And what I'm going to do as well is that I'm going to lower the highlights a little bit. Maybe I went a little too far. And I will open up the shadows a tiny bit as well. I think that the exposure and the contrast are fine. I will increase the clarity just a tiny bit. I will not touch the dehaze in this case. And of course, I will give a little bit of vibrance and a little bit of saturation. Let me stop right here 1 second, just to tell you that if you don't remember how every single Lightroom slider is going to affect the image, I will encourage you to go and check out my Lightroom mini-series beginner course that I did some weeks ago. Everything is in there. And let's open the tone curve. Here, I might push down the shadows a little bit, push up the highlights a little bit, and I want to give a little different look by opening the blacks a tiny bit. And let's see how it looks with and without this adjustment. Very subtle difference. I think I like it. Now I will skip the HSL panel and go into the split toning. In the split toning, what I want to try to achieve is to emphasize this sunset look. And I will do so by adding a little bit of color into the highlights. And in the shadows instead, I will add a little bit of blue tone before and after. Yeah, subtle changes that will make the difference in the end. Let's open the details. And in the details, I can see where we start to have problems caused by the very long exposure. You can see these dots, colored dots everywhere. These are called hot pixels. And the hot pixels are usually caused by the sensor in a very long exposure like this, when basically the sensor gets really warm. The camera gets very warm because it's working for a very extended amount of time. And this is the result. It's nasty. So I will do something here in the detail panel, but I don't think it's going to be enough. We might need to do something else in Photoshop. For now, I will decrease the sharpening to a minimum of 10, 11, 12, and I will decrease the radius of this sharpening. I will increase the details, and I'm always keeping an eye into this very zoomed image to see how my adjustments are affecting the hot pixels. I'm going back to the full image by clicking on Z. I will hold the Option key, move the masking slider to the right in order to decide what I want to be affected by the sharpening. I can see that those hot pixels are going to be affected unless I go to 100, but I might need to do something like this, like masking most of the image. So everything that stays white is going to be affected. All the black is not going to be touched by the sharpening. I will zoom in again, and I might add a little bit of noise reduction, increasing the luminance a tiny bit. I can also move the slider, the color slider, to the right as much as I can, and I can see that somehow the hot pixel are reduced compared to before. You can see how big and crazy they are if I'm not touching this slider. So I will go all the way to the right. Let me see. Unfortunately, they are still there. So definitely I will need to finish this edit in Photoshop. And I will show you a very quick tool that will take care of these hot pixels. When I imported this image, I made sure that the remove chromatic aberration and the enable profile corrections were already taken care of, so nothing to do here. What I will do here instead is that in the effects panel, I want to add a little bit of pigmenting. And I usually like to add a -7, -8 vignetting, the midpoint all the way to 0, the roundness maybe here, and I like to work with the feather quite a bit. You can see that without the feather you will have this funky round, which we don't want to see, of course. And this is basically done as far as it concerns the general adjustments. What I want to do right now instead is going into some local adjustment. The very first one is the graduated filter. I will drag down from the top, holding the shift key in order to keep it parallel to the horizon. And here I just want to decrease the highlights. I want to increase a little bit the contrast, maybe a little bit of saturation. And also I might want to add a little bit of color, and let's see how it's going to look. Yeah, this can work. Maybe this is even better. And I want to have a little darker just to create a more moody image. I will add a new graduated filter. This time is going to come from the bottom. I might actually need to have a little bit of a tilt in this case. And here instead I want to increase the shadows a little bit, not too much, maybe also the whites. I will increase the clarity and I will increase the saturation. I also want to see how it's going to look if I add a little bit of orange. Maybe this is too much, so I will move it at 19%, maybe a little less. And of course, even in this case, I can see how it looks with or without these adjustments. And we can see that these local adjustments are making a very big difference to the mood of the entire image. Something else that I like to take care of is that the sea is a little dark for my taste. I want to give this ethereal look to the water, and I want to make it a little brighter. So I will need to use the brush tool, and I will use the mask overlay to see exactly if I'm able to affect the right area of this image. And I will just paint until the entire area that I want to be affected will be actually red. And now that I am somehow happy of my selection, I will toggle off the mask overlay and start increasing the shadows and also increasing the exposure. And I can see that my selection wasn't that precise, so I will need to work at it a little better in order to have a more consistent result. So it will take me some time. So I'm a little happier now. I only think that the sky is too bright, still too bright, and I will increase the contrast. I might add a little bit of the dehaze, and maybe this is done. So let's see the before and after. Clearly a big difference. I'm not sure this is the mood that Chris was searching for, but this is what I saw. Now, the last thing we need to do is to bring this image in Photoshop, because as you can see, the hot pixels are still there, even if we brightened the water quite a bit. So right click, edit in Photoshop, and here in Photoshop, the first thing I will do is that with Command J, I will create a new layer. I will zoom in at 100% in order to be able to see very well the hot pixels, and clearly you see them. I will open a filter, noise, dust and scratches, and here is where the magic will happen. As a matter of fact, with a radius of 2 or 3 pixels and a threshold of 25, in this case the hot pixels are gone. If I move the threshold at 255, nothing basically is touched. And the trick here is to move the threshold to the left until all your hot pixels are gone. The radius, you don't want to go too crazy with the number here. The lower the number, the better it is, because if you go with the higher number, you will lose a lot of details from your image. And now I can just save my image, and the image will be saved automatically with this adjustment in Lightroom. Again, once the image is saved back to Lightroom from Photoshop, I will see that it will be saved with the extension of a TIFF file. And again, I'm pretty happy with the result. And this is the after. What do you think? And this is all for today. I hope you enjoyed this video. I hope you learned something new, and I hope you will let me know. So hit that like button, leave me a comment, and if you didn't yet, maybe this is the right time to subscribe. Thanks for watching, and I will see you in the next video.